You're listening to the Hollywood in Toto podcast, the right take on entertainment.
Now let's get to this week's HitCast interview. I recently read about an upcoming film called Unplanned. It takes a critical look at Planned Parenthood. Well, what caught my attention beyond that? It seems pretty rare on the surface, but the film had to shoot in secret because of the target in question. And one of the film's key financiers is a guy best known for giving us a better night's sleep. Yes, Mike Lindell of MikePillow.com fame cut a sizable check to make Unplanned a reality. He explains why here, along with his hesitation to become a film financier. It wasn't an easy transition for him, but I think he's doing it for the right reasons. He shares a lot more, too, including his connection to President Trump and some interesting plans for entrepreneurs, all in this week's HitCast interview. I hope you enjoy my chat with Mike Lindell. Well, Mike, thanks for joining the show. And I wanted to start by going back in time just a little bit and look at when you first decided, you know, you've got all this success. I want to get into the movie business. I want to kind of invest some of my capital. I want to get in that game. And from tell me a little bit your thought processes. What made you go into that decision? And was there a specific moment or a film or a thought? Kind of describe that for me.
The only thought I had was I was back in 2014, and I was with I had just met Stephen Baldwin, and we were driving through. We became friends right away, and we were driving through Times Square, and I said, Stephen, I said, someday are my book's going to come out? I got my book. I'm writing this book, and I said, someday I'm going to be making a movie from the book, and I'd really like to learn that industry. I said, could I come to one of your movies sometime and with you? And he says, I'll do you one better, brother. He said, let's make a movie. You could learn a lot more that way.
Huh. And did you immediately kind of recognize that the value of that, or were you kind of skeptical? What was your initial reaction?
No, that's exactly what I wanted to do, is go out and because when I go into something. I micromanage it and macromanage it, and I wanted to learn all about the movie before I come out with my movie, mm-hmm. which would be, you know, that's the extent I wanted to be in the movie industry, was to learn everything I could about my movie. And I thought, well, you know, let's make a movie in between.
Now, obviously, Stephen was helping you along the way to a certain extent. Were there other people, kind of mentors you had along the way, who helped you learn the business, get a feel for what you need to do, what's important, what's not important? What was that process like?
No, Stephen and I, then we went out and we made a movie. It's coming out too this year, called Church People. And I had a cameo in it, and I just learned the, you know, financing end of it. I had, it was fun. I had an act, you know, a part in it. And then I was approached last summer about this movie Unplanned, and to be have a part in that. And the movie had a message that matched my beliefs, and I thought, I wouldn't get a part of anything unless I thought it was a great movie, and it would and everything. I'd done my due diligence, and these guys, I called them back, and I said, I'll do that.
Now, I understand that the message behind Unplanned is something that you agree with. Is there more about the film that intrigued you, or that kind of got you invested in the project? What kind of jumped out at you about the script and the whole production team, in a sense?
No, it was just the message. It was totally the message, and they wanted me to do a part in it. They wanted me to be. They called me and wanted me to do a part in it. I added on them putting money into it because okay. they said, "Would you? There's a part in it, and that's we've prayed about it, and we think that you're the one for the. Or we've gotten that you're the one we should get to do that cameo." Mm-hmm. And I said, okay, what is it? And I said, I said, well, let me think about it. And then they told me all the, what the movie was about, and to get that their passion was to get the message out there. And I said, it would have to be a quality movie. I would never put my money into anything that, it's not for me. It's not about making money. It's about I want quality things out there. Quality and a set a great message, and And after talking to the guys, they said I checked into what they had done before, and it was going to be a great movie. And then I decided, you know what, I'm going to put some money into it myself. So I put $1 million in.
Now, when it comes to some of the infomercials you've done, I was seeing that you were bit more comfortable ad-libbing than sort of reading off a script. That was sort of more your style. Did you find these cameo roles to be challenging? Did it kind of come to you more easily than you expected? What was the acting side of things like for you?
The first one I did, where we filmed 2 years ago in Church People, I was a lot more nervous then. You go back to when I made my first infomercial, I always had unworthiness, spirit, fear of rejection. And the first night we filmed my infomercial in 2011, the producer texted the other guy the night before and said, "This is the worst guy I've ever seen. He's never going to make it on TV."
Oh, no.
And, so the next day I did. I walked. The first line was that I took 9 takes. It was in front of a real audience and a friend of mine, and I said, "This isn't going to work." I said, "You guys should bring a table in, and we'll take." No, I can't use a teleprompter, and I need to do just like I sold my pillows at the shows, and then I was able to do it just ad lib. But I got gotten better. This last movie with Unplanned, I just had a few lines, so that's not that wasn't as hard. But movies are a little different than I learned. Than like if you do an infomercial, or if you're doing something in front of a speech in front of an audience, and using a teleprompter. In movies, you do little snidbits, little pieces, so you can still say it with passion and stuff. And it was very interesting to see how movies were made, where it's not like two people are sitting there talking going, and you do a 5-minute conversation. It's like I'd say and I move the chair over there, you know, and I move the chair over there, you know, and then that person might say his lines. I might not even be in the room. I mean, it's amazing how they, you know, that's not just all one sequence, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's sort of, you don't realize it when you're watching in the
No,
theater.
You don't. So it's amazing how they're made.
There was a story about your new movie Unplanned, and it was in the Hollywood Reporter. And one of the bits of information they revealed was that it was shot either mostly or partially in secret. And they said because it was a film critical of Planned Parenthood. And I thought, well, whether you're pro Planned Parenthood or critical of it, this is America, and you can make any movie you want. It really struck me. Can you talk about that? What did that mean? And what kind of pressures were within the screen, sort of on you for that production?
Well, I went down there I was there a day and a half, and this is what I heard from all them. And the word, I think they were afraid of so much controversy and basically attacks from people that are pro-choice, and it's and attacks from it's a very controversial thing, Planned Parenthood, and any place that's doing the things they're doing, and they have a person just like when Abby Johnson was gone after back when she quit Planned Parenthood. If people are doing things that are not good, I'm not going to use any stronger words than that, but it's not good. They don't want to be exposed for who they are, and if you don't want to be exposed, you're certainly going to try or at least we had the movie producers and everybody had a fear of them trying to stop getting the word out. So I think that was the basis for that. I'm sure that Abby Johnson's own experience, what happened to her when she left there, a lot of that was probably based on that. They don't want the word to get out what she went through and what happened, what really goes on there and everything else.
Yeah. When you think about movies today, a lot of movies are made to kind of change minds, to convince people, to kind of open people up to new ideas. With a film like Unplanned, what do you see as its potential where, you know, it's going to be in thousands of theaters potentially? People are going to be watching it. They may be watching it on streaming in a few months, you know, after the theatrical window closes. What kind of impact do you think it could have?
I think it'll have a big impact because it's a true story. When you watch a movie, anybody watching a true story, and, you know, you're in my for me, that was another thing, too. I didn't just jump on board. I had to do my due diligence and find out, what did she know? What did she experience? What was the truth? So you get movies that are made for Hollywood and they change the truth. I think everybody, producer, everyone, this wanted to be where you can't go, okay, that really didn't happen. No, it really did happen. And I think that's what's really going to resonate with people and expose Planned Parenthood and abortion for what it is and for what they're, for what's really going on out there.
You're a self-made millionaire. You're now a film producer. Was there more overlap between the two than you expected? What was that sort of that transition like?
I don't consider myself a film producer. I mean, like I say, I did this one. I didn't plan on it. They reached out to me. I've got my book coming out, and when that comes out, now I feel I'm going to be. Everyone's approached me, so I've learned, you know, what's going to be good out there. Who I would pick to, you know, I have all these choices now. Who I would pick to help me get my movie or my book to the screen, and. Because my book, my story, life story, is going to have an amazing message out there for people. It's going to help so many people in addiction. I was a former crack addict, and this was one of the things I, you know, for me, this is telling a true story. My book is, and my movie is also going to be a true story. So am I going to come out with five movies, two movies? I don't plan on it. My big calling is evangelism and spreading the word of Jesus. And that's my, that's where my pillow is just a platform for that purpose. And, you know, I enjoy speaking out to, I was in Minnesota, 50,000 millennials at US Bank Stadium. I did another, told my story at, Texas Speedway this fall. I don't know, 20, 30,000 people. I'm going to be speaking at, Liberty University, come up at a lot of college campuses and giving people hope, the story of hope, where I got free of my addictions. And that's where, you know, I don't want people to think, I mean, no, I'm not doing any movies to them. When I do my movie, all that money, the money I make will be going to the kingdom. It's going to go to help my recovery network I have coming out, my Lindell Recovery Network and my foundation. It's just giving back. And mm-hmm. I just think that this movie Unplanned and the movie I have Church People coming out, but both of them, the one has a great message. It's a Christian comedy. And the other one has an absolute true story, great message. And it's a good movie. I had to make sure you guys, this is going to be a quality movie as far as production, right? Because I'm not even going to do that. Even if the movie had a good message, I want it to be people that enjoy watching it, that it's a quality movie. You know what I mean?
Yep. You know, when you think about what you're doing and putting money into something that you believe in, there are a lot of people on the right, and I kind of use that term kind of a little bit loosely, maybe people of faith, there's a lot of intersect there, and they say, well, why don't more people like you who have financial means, why don't they put that into Hollywood? Because the messaging out of Hollywood is more often of the left, more secular in nature. Why do you think that you kind of saw the connection between pop culture and a message where other people maybe in your situation aren't?
Well, that's where I live, in that arena. I mean, I've been on TV 2,500,000 times now. This is the world I live in. When I met our president, before he was president, in a divine appointment on August 15, 2016, I didn't know anything about politics. I met him in a private meeting. We talked about what he was going to do with the inner cities and addictions, and, you know, that he's just signed this amazing opiate bill, we talked about jobs, my thing, Made in America, remember, Made in the USA. And I walked out there and said, he's going to be the best president in history. And I talked to his employees. It was like talking to my employees. And I'm going, wow, this guy is amazing. I went all in. I believed in it. I went all in. And then I had to learn what politics were, and, you know, a right and a left, a liberal, conservative. I know where I fall. I'm very conservative, but I would never go against my Christian values. For instance, in the last election, I had, there was a couple Republicans wanting me to endorse them, and they, And they were pro-choice. I said, absolutely not. I'm not going to, you know, they can just hear it. Oh, Mike Lindell endorsed a Republican that and went against his Christian values. Mm-hmm. That's my number one. And that's where, and I'm not afraid of it. I bore my cross on TV from the day one. And I'm not afraid of hiding from anybody or putting, I put it right out there. Yeah, I was a former crack cocaine addict. There's no shame in me. I can't help my past. I, you know, what happened, and I can only use it for good. And so I'm not afraid of, Hollywood. In fact, I did a piece out in California in Hollywood right before the 2016 election. I was joking around telling, you know, we're talking, and I said, vote Trump. And there was 45 people in that room, and they got silence, and everybody got weird on me. And then throughout the day, 44 of them, or whoever, everybody except one person came out to me and said, I'm really voting for him, but I can't say that here. So one person controlled that whole group of people, and the other ones were afraid to say, hey, I'm going to vote for Donald Trump. And they're going, what? You know, it was only one person in there that was not voting for him. Mm-hmm. So this is how they, you know, they've controlled. I've learned now how horrific it is that they control the media. And you know what? I'll say it right out. I've never seen such fake garbage news in my whole life, because you know what? They say stuff about me that isn't true, and I get attacked almost daily for my beliefs. And it's free speech. And I get, oh, boycott something. They'll do it. They want me to boycott somebody's station. You know, boycott My Pillow. Boycott Mike Lindell. And it's funny because somebody will put up there. There'll be bots and trolls on Twitter, and someone will say, don't boycott My Pillow. He'll just double his ads, and we see him enough already. You know, so I'm not afraid of that. I'm not, you know, I'm not changing what God's blessed me with and how I'm spreading his word. And I'll say it again. I'm so proud of our president, the stuff he's done in spite of all the attacks. Nobody, everyone I have, where I'm from in Minnesota here, everybody's employees. It seems like what's the highest, everybody, there's careers now around where My Pillow, I was paying everybody great before, and now it seems like all other companies are too. Everybody's in the best condition we've been in. And I work so hand in hand with the inner cities, with my foundation and recovery addiction network, that everything's going in the right direction and great. And it's just, I just can't believe it. I get very frustrated sometimes that people can't see that going, you know, hey, you guys, take politics out of it. These are common sense things. We have a common sense president. Common sense. It's all common sense. You know, instead of everyone, well, who's going to get voted in next time? Who's going to get voted in this time? Well, we're not going to do stuff over here because we might not get voted in. Our president's not afraid of that. He's doing the right thing, and he's doing what's right for this country and the people in it.
You know, through the years, you've been very open about your sobriety and your what you went through. And congratulations on your 10-year mark for being sober. Is there ever a moment when you kind of reflect on that, the darker times in your life, especially when you're kind of preparing a movie of that experience, where it becomes a challenge where maybe you don't want to face it or don't want to revisit it? Or are you in a place now where you can just see it all and process it and it doesn't bring you down in a sense?
No, I can go back and go right back to every one of those spots. I can go back to how I felt. I kept things back from the day, knowing that someday I would be writing a book about it and the things that happened. And do I have regrets? I don't have any. I wouldn't change anything in my life if it changed where I'm at right now. Mm-hmm. And my, you know, my story of the stuff I went through, and the stuff that happened with the, you know, getting into crack and losing 20-year marriage and whatever, you know, dysfunction there was with my family, everything that went on, that's the story of hope now where I'm at now. If I go, oh boy, I could go back and change something and wish I wouldn't have done that. Well, if I don't have any regrets, because I'm where I'm at now, it's the story and the amazing platform that God's given me that can go out and help other people, show them the hope and use that for good. I'm not, That's why I say for me, money, I take my money and I drive around in a pickup truck and I don't eat with two forks. I take all that money and I use it for big things for the kingdom, for God, for Jesus Christ, to help other people with addictions or other people that are. I've got so many amazing things coming out where my foundation, wherever the need is, 100% of the money is going to go to the need with no overhead. I got tired of, you see these charities or foundations where people don't trust them anymore because you look at them, you go, well, I wonder how much their CEO makes or their president of the foundation. Are those really my kids in the picture? Does everybody have the same ones? Gee, does 50 cents of my dollar made it to the actual need? Well, here 100% of your money is going to make it there. And that. So these are things I'm doing that's gonna help. I never needed a big house. I got it. You know, I just love what I'm doing because I love helping people and I love giving back.
Gotcha. One last question before we let you go. When it comes to, you know, you're an entrepreneur at heart, and what you've created with MyPillow is just amazing. Having been in the film industry for now, to the extent you have a little bit of acting, some investing, what has that taught you as someone who is, I think it sends an entrepreneur to heart.
Well, it tells me I might do something that I never thought I'd ever do. I might play myself in my own movie and my life story. And I've thought of that. And also, I've also realized how powerful that industry is with messaging. And so will I maybe get into that? I don't know. I want to have my own hour TV show that I am getting my own studio where I can hopefully get my own hour show to get messages out there. I want to do a show where it's the hour of hope, where I tell all the good things that are going on in our country and things that are working so everybody can duplicate them. I'm also, now that you mentioned entrepreneur, I want to put in one here. This will be the first time told on anybody's show. Entrepreneurs and inventors have approached me for probably 2 years, and I've saved up a stack, foot and a half tall. And entrepreneurs in this country, they get their products get attacked, they get copied on Amazon, they get you can't get in the box stores. If you do, if you go to shows and home shows and fairs, your patents are good, they'll get copied and shipped in from overseas. Well, what I have, I'm coming out with, or I have a platform that's going to be launching called mystore.com. And it's going to be a safe platform for entrepreneurs where they're vetted. I have another company or another thing, a team vetting these products and to get up there. And if anybody's listening, you can actually go to mystore.com and you will see a way to put in your product and to get a safe place to put it. And this will be, and the money that's made off the platform of mystore.com, most of that's going to go to finance my foundation, which is going to help people. It's all one big circle, but it's going to really help the entrepreneurs, all the great ideas you've had. And this would include, you know, when you talk about movie, one of the things up there might be a movie that I have put my integrity and credibility on, saying this is a good thing. You don't just get to put a product up there. The product's either got to help people in their faith mentally, physically, or helping the entrepreneur, you know, made in the USA, things like this that have a reason to be up there. There's not going to be a product put up there that a better coffee cup that looks shinier that somebody to make money. Mm-hmm. So
I'd love to hear that. I'm glad you're helping out so many people, and we'll look forward to the movie Unplanned coming out this spring, March 22nd. Thank you, Mike Lindell, for joining the HitCast, and of course, MyPillow.com for the best pillow around. And we look forward to more film projects and more everything from you. Sounds like your plate is overfilling, and I'm really just really pleased that you're spending a few minutes with us, and wish you all the best, and congratulations again.
Thanks for having me on. It's an honor.
Well, thanks again for listening. Don't forget to check out HollywoodandToto.com for both the show notes and, of course, the latest entertainment news. Please follow me at Twitter at HollywoodandToto. And we'd love it if you leave a podcast review over at iTunes. See you next week.